Good morning, church. We're going to begin worship today. I invite everybody to stand as we sing together.
Continue to worship, read responsively with me. It'll be up on the screens, and I'll read the regular type, and you read the bold type. This is from Psalm 136. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His faithfulness is everlasting.
Give thanks to the God of gods.
His faithfulness is everlasting.
Give thanks to the Lord of lords.
His faithfulness is everlasting.
To him who alone does great wonders, to him who made the heavens with skill,
to him who spread out the earth above the waters, to him who made the great lights,
the sun to rule by day, the moon and the stars to rule by night.
His faithfulness is everlasting.
He remembered us in our lowliness, and he has rescued us from our enemies.
His faithfulness is everlasting.
Give thanks to the God of heaven.
His faithfulness is everlasting.
Amen. Amen. God is good. Amen. He is good, and his faithfulness is everlasting. Welcome to worship at First Baptist Church. We're so glad that you're here. If this is your first time ever, welcome. You're in the right place. Don't run off. We've got about an hour ahead of you, and we're glad that you made it today. If you've been here many, many times, it's good to see you again. We love you and welcome. There is a blue information connection card there in your worship bulletin. If you're in the room or if you're worshiping online, you can go in the comments and let us know who you are, or if there are any prayer requests that you have, write those down on the blue card or in the comment section on Facebook, and we want to be able to pray for you this week and care for you. For those of you that are filling out the blue cards, you can just place them in one of the offering plates as you leave, and it'll be our privilege to pray over those this week. Let's pray as we continue to worship. God, you have done great wonders. You did make the heavens with skill. You did spread out the earth above the waters, and you did make all the great lights. You made the sun to rule by day and the moon and stars by night. You are our Creator. And we are here today to worship you and to give you your due, all that we can. And we thank you so much for the blood of Jesus that covers us and makes us pleasing and acceptable to you as we sing, as we give, as we serve and respond to you today. In the name of Jesus, we continue to worship. Amen.
Let's stand back up again, church.
Never fails. Christ long to follow Jesus, for he has said that he will bring me home. And day by day, I know he will renew me until I say,
the offering now. Bow our heads. Father, I just want to come before you today and thank you. Praise your name, Lord. Thank you, Father, for letting us have another day to worship you, for being in this country, Lord, that we're still allowed to. Father, we thank you for those hearts that are here that are providing these offerings and ask that you bless them and bless the offering that we're about to receive. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. So this next song that we're going to do, I grew up singing this in the Baptist church. Now, I know not all of you grew up in the Baptist church. But if you did, and you know this next song, sing it out so everybody else can hear you. But folks, this is about proclaiming our faith out in this lost world that we live in here in Santa Fe and around the world. It's called Jesus Saves. And so everybody stand up. We can't sit down for this one. All right, so stand up and let's sing it out, everybody. Here we go.
We have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around. Jesus saves, Jesus saves.
Shout salvation. That was fun. Have everybody have a seat. We're now going to have the kids come on up for Pastor's Pals. This is a time with Pastor Reed. Come on up, kids, and you can sit down here around Pastor Reed. Doesn't matter what age you are, if you're a kid, as long as you're not more than 10 or 11, come on down.
Hey, guys, how you doing? You good? Welcome. I like your pretty dresses and masks. You guys can keep coming down. Come sit down here anywhere you want. I want to ask you guys, tell you a saying and see if you can figure out the meaning of this saying. This is something people say, okay? The saying goes like this: there is no I in team. There's no I in team. Anybody have a guess? What does that mean? Anybody? No guesses. You kind of have a guess over there, Mr. William? Yeah? So there's no I in team. It means two things, okay? It means you don't spell team with an I in it. Did you know that? You spell team T-E-A-M. Is there an I? No I, okay? There's also a second meaning. When you have a team, you need all the team members to focus on the good of the team and not the good of themselves. Does that make sense? You want them to put being a team together ahead of trying to be the most amazing person by themselves. Now, don't say any names, but do you guys have you ever had a friend who thinks only about herself and doesn't think about other people? Have you ever had a friend like that, Chloe? Don't say a name. You have it? You have good friends. Good job. You guys over here, my men on my left, do you know a guy who wants you to play with him, but he only wants to pick the game that you play every time? He'll never let you pick. And he only wants to win the games that you play. He'll never let you win. He never laughs at your jokes, but only wants you to laugh at his jokes. You guys have any friends like that? Yeah, if you did, they wouldn't be good. They wouldn't be good. That's right. Well, listen, in church, we want to love people like that. Did you know that? Even people like that are welcome in church, but we also want to forgive them. And here's the thing. Those in church who get it, those in church who understand what church is supposed to be about, those we want to respect and follow are the ones who understand that the church is a team and there is no I in team. We have to understand here that this thing that we do isn't about any one of us. Who is church about? You guys know? There's one name. Yeah, Chloe. You got it. She gets it. Do we get it? Church is about Jesus. It's not about us. Let's pray together, church family. Father, we want church to be about you. And we want to all work together toward that end. We trust you to make it happen. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Guys, Mr. Chris has some worship bags for you. If you guys want to grab one, you can go back to your parents. Welcome.
Please turn with me to Acts chapter 2, verse 41 through 47. So those who received his word were baptized, and they were added that day about 3,000 souls. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing all the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day, and those who were being saved.
Let's pray, church. Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, the kids, I think I was striking out with them there for a few minutes, but it ended on a high note. They got it. Church is about Jesus. Imagine this. The year is 405, 405 AD, or Common Era. You live in the northeast of England. You are from an aristocratic family, a part of the ruling class of the Roman Empire, on the far northern edges of the empire. You're used to a certain amount of privilege. Your family knows some power. Following the conversion of Emperor Constantine in Rome only 80 years before this day, the whole tenor of the empire had begun to change. Christianity was now popular, in vogue. You went from being persecuted to now you were the popular ones. It was cool to be a Christian. And your grandfather had been a pastor. But you decided that Christian thing wasn't for you. You lived apart from the faith. You ridiculed the clergy. You made fun of the pastors. You found more fun with your wild teenage friends. Then one day in 405, you were just 16 years old. A band of Celtic Irish pirates came sprinting over the lush green hillside of your English town. Their weapons were brandished, sharp. You and your teenage friends had nothing to defend yourself with, and even if you did, these were seasoned warriors. You're helpless as your friends are quickly surrounded by sharp blades held by muscular men. You're captured. You're forced onto a ship, sailed back to Ireland, sold into slavery, and forced to herd cattle for your days. But then, amidst your slavery, a funny thing happens. You've lost all the power and prestige you used to know, and all of a sudden, those teachings of Christianity, which you used to make fun of, all of a sudden have become real. You had learned about God in your days as a child, and now, as you're out in the fields keeping the cattle of your enemies, you come to know God personally. You wrote about those days. You said, "After I had arrived in Ireland as a slave, I found myself pasturing flocks daily, and I started to pray a number of times each day, and it grew more and more, and the love and fear of God came to me. And faith grew, and my spirit was exercised until I was praying up to 100 times every day, and in the night, nearly as often." Well, who are you? Well, you're Patrick of Ireland, of course. We've been talking in these days about sharing our faith, and many do not know that the historical St. Patrick would probably be a little bit upset about how he is celebrated today with green drinks, beads, and four-leaf clovers. He wouldn't be too excited about that, I don't think. 6 years after being captured and enslaved, living in Ireland, tending these herds, Patrick had a vision from God, the God that he had come to know over those 6 years personally. And the vision said, "Get out of here, go home." And so he risked his life, escaped slavery, and boarded a ship as a stowaway and made it back safely to his home in England. God gave him a deep burden in England for the salvation of his enslavers. the hours. He couldn't stay in England. He couldn't keep living there. He had spent his time out in the fields learning from God and hearing from God. And now, 7 years later, all he could think about was getting back to England. He ended up going into a serious time of Bible study and learning, and then ended up returning as a missionary back to Ireland. And in fact, Patrick was one of the most successful missionaries in the history of the world. He founded 200 churches. 200 churches. He led 100,000 people to Christ. 100,000. He survived 12 attempts on his life along the way. His death on March 17th, 461, is the historical reason why Wednesday, March 17th, this last week was St. Patrick's Day. We're talking about sharing our faith. And I want to ask, how in the world did Patrick literally change an entire island for Jesus Christ? What were the methods that he used that allowed him to literally change a culture? What can we learn from him? Well, give me a minute and I'll tell you. Where have we been? We've been learning the evangelism process: prayer, care, share, together regularly. We said that we understand that evangelism, sharing the good news, might feel like chopping down the tallest tree in the forest without any tools to help you. We said that Satan has done a work in our culture to get people to believe today that the very purpose of Jesus for us to share our faith, to make disciples, our mission in life, Satan has convinced many of us is the very thing we could never do. Many Christians would never say it, but they've made up their minds deep down in their hearts, "Oh, I'm never going to do that." And yet that's the purpose that Christ has given us. We've said that our God is a loving Father, and He would never call us to a task, to a purpose, that He would not also give us all the tools we need. And in fact, He's given us power tools for accomplishing His mission. The early church followed the lead of the Holy Spirit, prayer. They were praying, but also watching and paying attention for open doors and then just walking through them. In our chapter that we've been studying, chapter 2, they do almost nothing, the apostles, except respond to the invitations and the open doors that the Holy Spirit gives them. Really, all they do is declare the gospel. Jesus says, "You will receive power when the Spirit has come upon you." Jesus says, "I will send you my helper who will come in my name." The power helper of our witness is the Holy Spirit. And they followed His lead, not mechanized programs. The early church was also ready with the gospel good news about Jesus, their Savior, and they were ready to share their testimony. They were ready to speak when the opportunities arose. We said a seed is one of the most powerful realities in all of creation. Yeah, it's small. Yeah, it's tiny. Yeah, memorizing a gospel presentation seems like it's not very much. And yet, what forest does not come from seeds? What plant-based foods that we eat don't come from seeds? The gospel is the power seed of salvation. So the Holy Spirit, the gospel, the early church was also full of love. It's all through here at the end of Acts 2. They obeyed the commands of Jesus and Paul and Peter and John to love God, love each other, and love the world in which they lived. Love is full of power to remove the most clogged up ears who don't want to hear the gospel and to soften the stoniest, hardest of hearts to receiving Jesus. So that's a little bit of a summary of where we've been. I want us to think back over those. We've talked about prayer, care, share. And I want us to realize that everything we've studied in our evangelism series so far, everything that I just said, could be done alone. If we wanted to, we could pray, we could care for people, we could share the gospel all by ourselves. And often we are taught that we should share faith all by ourselves. Oftentimes, without even realizing it, we're taught that sharing our faith depends solely and completely on us as individuals by ourselves, a solitary endeavor. That is not how the Bible puts it. It's not. We are often taught that. But notice first on your handout, the early church does not share Jesus alone. We are to pray, care, and share together. Together, we certainly have individual responsibilities from Jesus to get into the game, to help make disciples. We are to get in and act and play and be a part. But we also don't have to play the game by ourselves. Evangelism is a team sport. One of the biggest power tools in the New Testament that so much of the New Testament is trying to encourage us in and tell us about is to see the church as our team in the game. This is a team sport. I mentioned before that we have often siloed evangelism. We've been taught or we've thought that, you know, evangelism is only this thing that's done for 1 hour on Sunday nights at 5, or that it's this thing that you get trained and you got to go out and do it all by yourself. But here in the New Testament, remember, this is Acts 2 is the very earliest of the church. The Holy Spirit is given here in Acts 2, and notice how connected it is to everything else they do, their witness. Just look with me over this passage here at the end of Acts 2. Look at Acts 2:42. They were continually devoting themselves. One guy? No, they themselves. Verse 43, everyone kept feeling. Verse 44, and all those who, they were doing all these things together. They're a team. Think about how different that is than the way preachers like me often describe evangelism or sharing our faith. Preachers and teachers like me often make it sound like an individual sport. You have to do all the sharing. You have to bring your friends all by yourself. See, one of the key ways that we can misread this book, and often is misread, is through the Western eyes of individualism. Western countries are very individualistic, especially in America. There's a ton of good that can come from that, a strong work ethic, tough individuals who are able to succeed in life. There is good there. But it's problematic when our individualism causes us to misread the Bible. See, this book teaches us that every member must get in the game and that sharing Jesus is a team effort together. Both are true. Individual responsibilities, communal responsibilities. When Jesus says a verse that we love at First Baptist, the end of Matthew, all authority in heaven on earth has been given to me, therefore go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. To whom is he speaking? When Jesus gives the Great Commission, who does he give it to? Well, he's speaking to all his disciples, and in fact, every part of that command is a second person plural. Second person plural, English class for just a minute. Remember, what does a second person plural sound like? I hope that this is one of those things you get from me and you remember it forever and ever. A second person plural sounds like y'all, okay? That's what it sounds like. Or, you know, if you're anti-y'all, you guys, or utes, use guys. Spanish is actually helpful. They put it down and write it, ustedes, and we get to see it there. I actually think it's helpful in the translation to see that. I'm from Texas. I can't hide it, so y'all is the official read translation for me. See, y'all go. Y'all make disciples. Y'all teach them everything I've taught you. Y'all baptize them. Do you hear it? Not just one. Do this together, individual and communally. I want you to think about for your life and for sharing Jesus with people you know the power of this. Now all of a sudden, it still is your responsibility to share. All those things are still true. But let's take on the other half of the truth. Now I have this team to help me in my efforts wherever I go, with my family, with my coworkers, with my baristas, with my grocery store clerks. It's not just about me. It's about us together. See, the church is one of the greatest gifts to our calling to share our faith. We don't have to do evangelism alone. We weren't meant to. We're meant to get in the game with a big team. We've got big seven-footers who can dunk that ball like crazy. We've got these three-point shooting ladies who never miss. The early church doesn't share Jesus alone, but shares through, notice second, multi-giftedness. Multi-giftedness. Often when we're talking about the multi-giftedness of the church, we think only about inside the church and Christians, but no. It's all the same thing. The multi-giftedness means as much for our sharing faith outside the church as it does for inside. See, when we siloed out evangelism and just said it's this one thing for 1 hour and it's not related to discipleship, it's not related to worship, it's not related to the sermon, in that case, we have missed out on all those other gifted people who help us in those tasks. Evangelism should be empowered by the multi-gifted church. Think about this for your evangelism. What are some of the reasons that, and honestly, excuses, right, that we don't share our faith? Well, see, I'm an introvert, and I don't like people. Let me say a little bit about introverts. Number one, I'm one. Number two, it's not okay for us to just say we don't like people and give up on evangelism. Jesus gives the call to share our faith to whom? All Christians. But you introverts, me an introvert, think about this. Where are some of the most gifted, talkative, bubbly people that you know that are really good at doing hospitality and making others feel welcome? Where are those wonderful, loving, sweet, smiling people at? At church? On a Sunday morning? Ready to welcome others in? Man, we have some fantastic people who are so good at making us feel loved in this room and in the overflow room downstairs when we gather as a church on Sunday morning. We have some amazing people here at FBC, don't we? Greeters, usher team, security team, you guys do a great job of making this room and the overflow room feel so loving. What about this reason people don't feel adequate to do evangelism? Well, I'm not a very good speaker. I don't know theology very well. I might get it wrong, or I'm going to mess up sharing Christ correctly. First of all, Jesus doesn't say we have to share Him perfectly. He just says to do it and to trust Him. But also, where would we find, hopefully, a fairly gifted speaker and theologian who kind of is okay at sharing Jesus? Hopefully at our church on a Sunday morning. It's probably your connection group teacher, right? Not me. Okay, I get it. Friends, I believe as we look around Santa Fe, we think about the people in this town, I think the greatest felt need of people in this town is community. I think that the thing that people are starving for, the thing that people are desiring in our town is friendship, is love, is a community. Well, where do you know a community of love that might help you to help that person feel loved? Man, I hope it's here. I feel that way about you. I hope you feel that way. Church is one of God's greatest gifts to our calling to share our faith. Acts 1:8. The chapter right before Acts 2, where we are this morning. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea, Samaria, and to the end of the earth. No, that is not how the Greek reads. Instead, Jesus says this, but y'all will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon y'all, and y'all will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. I checked the Greek again this week. All second person plurals. If you don't like Texas, just say ustedes, okay, in Española. That's fine. It is a command that describes all of us. We together will be his witnesses. Where did we get the idea that we have to do this all by ourselves? Think with me about the life of Jesus for just a minute. You know the story, don't you remember? This guy has a lame friend, but he wanted his paralyzed friend to meet Jesus. This guy knew Jesus was the Messiah and could heal his lame friend. And so this guy yanks his friend on his mat to the house where Jesus was. He throws out his back in the process. He burns a hole in his friend's mat, his poor friend who was paralyzed. He rips a hole in it. But finally, he gets his friend drugged to the house where Jesus is. But there's another problem. The house where Jesus is teaching is completely full. It's wall to wall, shoulder to shoulder. There is no way he's going to be able to drag that friend into that house, especially since he just threw out his back. So he figures, I could lift my friend to the roof, and then I could get my friend down into Jesus, right in front of Jesus, by tearing a hole in the roof. So he lifts this guy up, and he gets this guy up on his shoulders. But remember, his friend is paralyzed. He can't really help. And so he starts to sway, and then all of a sudden he can't hold the weight of his friend anymore, and he starts to lean backwards, and he drops his friend flat on his face. That was really helpful for his paralyzed friend, wasn't it? Is that the story? No. No, it is not. Mark chapter 2, Jesus has how many friends helping his paralyzed friend, their paralyzed friend come to Jesus? 4, helping their one friend come. Where did we get the idea that this is supposed to be done alone? Jesus sends out his disciples all by themselves, doesn't he? No, he sends them out how? 2 by 2, in community with help. But often the way we view evangelism, it looks more like my fictitious version, doesn't it? I've got to do it all by myself. Do you feel that pressure on you? And what I want to say to us this morning is look around and look at your friends. Look at the other church leaders who serve beside you and say, this is my team for my friends who are still lame, who haven't been saved and come to know Jesus personally. Listen to Ephesians 15 and 16. Ephesians 4, 15 and 16. But speaking the truth in love, that's one of the verses we're using for evangelism, that all of our speaking the truth is to be done in love. Now listen to the context. We are to grow up into all aspects into him who is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body, being fitted and held together by what every joint supplies according to the proper working of each individual part, causes the growth of the body for the building itself up in love. Our multi-giftedness is for the world as much as it is for each other. So I want you to imagine this week. Instead of viewing this task of evangelism as that tree in the forest that I've asked you to chop down all by yourself without anything to help you, I want you to imagine that you start praying and watching for the Holy Spirit to open doors and to give you little ins and little outs where you can begin to share Jesus where I can. And then you just start loving and caring and serving. And we talked about on Wednesday night, sometimes the loving takes a long time, doesn't it? Sometimes it takes forever. But we keep loving and we don't give up. And we are ready for the moments that Jesus is going to give us. And then to add now to your individual efforts, all those members of your church, do you start to feel the power that God has given you in sharing your faith? You're not by yourself. He has given you tools that are perfect for the task. And not only that, remember what we studied in the first week of this series. That the one who is really good at drawing people to Jesus, the one who has said it is his task, is God Himself, the Holy Spirit. It's what He does. My prayer is that we would see our church as the Holy Spirit-led team, the best team on planet Earth for accomplishing the mission of God. And we do that in our multi-giftedness, but also in the simple calling to gather and to scatter. Finally, on your handout, gathering and scattering. Look back at Acts 2 with me. Look at verse 44. Acts 2:44. And all those who believed were together and had all things in common. In verse 46, look down at 46. Day by day, continuing with one mind in the temple and breaking bread from house to house. They were taking their meals together. I'm not going to go on a Baptist rant again. I did that 2 weeks ago. There's a lot of eating that happens four times, I believe, the way I count. But they were taking their meals together with gladness and sincerity of heart, and they were doing it from house to house. So do you see that? There's the big group. They meet together in the temple. That would have been preaching and worship, but they also meet together in small groups, connection groups, so they can know each other. You know, in a room like this, it's easy to be anonymous, isn't it? But you see the pattern of the early church here was to also get together into small groups to study the Bible. They meet together in homes. They eat together. They meet for the apostles' teaching and prayer, but they also meet for fun and to love one another. But then notice how they also must, the fact that they were getting together as is described here, implied in that is that they were also scattering so that they could meet together again. Do you see the implications there? And then look what happens. Look at the result. Look at verse 47. And the Lord was adding to their number day by day those who were being saved. Often when people talk about evangelism, they say we have to get outside of the church walls. I have said that. I bet a lot of you have said that. And I want to tell you that is true, but it is only a half truth. It is only a half truth. The Holy Spirit is causing new believers, non-believers, young believers, immature believers, and never been believers before to walk into their gatherings. How else are people getting saved as a part of their gatherings? I would never suggest that we don't get outside the church walls. We are commanded to go into prisons and hospitals and orphanages, aren't we? It's part of what Jesus commands us to do. But that's a part of the scattering out. And we need to also be ready as we gather together. Church, the Greek word is ekklesia. It means gathering. And as we do that, we will see God work in our midst. What we do in our gatherings, by the way, is fairly defined in Scripture. When we come together, we are to read Scripture, to pray, to sing, to love and care for each other, to declare the Word of God to one another, to build one another up. The Holy Spirit calls us to do those things, and as we're faithful and we obey, He will bring the lost inside of the church. But as we meet in other ways, there's other ways that we can meet and be less formal and do other things. And then as we scatter into our schools, neighborhoods, and businesses with all these power tools that we've been studying into the usual segments of our lives, Jesus wants us to just be us in His Spirit. He wants us to be loving and kind, gentle and slow to anger. Remember, all this stuff is integrated, the fruit of the Spirit. He wants us to be incredible teachers and sweet grandmothers and wonderful bosses and loyal employees. We are to pray, care, share together and then on a regular basis. He wants us to keep looking. He wants us to gather back up. We start praying and watching for the Holy Spirit to move, and we start loving a friend, and we see, ooh, I've got a chance. I think this guy is asking me why I go to church. Pick my jaw up off the floor. That might be a chance to share my faith. He asked me why I go to church, and we start sharing, and we mess it up. We fall flat on our face. It does not go well. We say the wrong things about Jesus. We come back to church. And our connection group leader starts to encourage us, and our friends are there. We realize, you know, I messed up. But that doesn't mean that God doesn't still care about that person. And we ask our Sunday school teacher, tell me a little bit more about what is the gospel? I didn't get it right. And we go back. And we bring that friend and say, hey, I've got somebody I want you to meet. I'm kind of quiet, but you need to meet Burnett. Burnett is not quiet, and she smiles really sweetly, and she'll love you. And I want to introduce you to Connie. She makes these gluten-free cookies. You're going to love those. And Sharon has a prayer group. You need to be a part of that prayer group. You wouldn't be alone, and you don't need to be scared to come to church because we have the best security team in the world. It's led by this guy named Dan. He's a biker, but he's a good biker. And you need to get to know our chairman of deacons and our connection group leaders, and on and on and on. See, when that kind of spirit-led, gospel-driven teamwork starts happening, it is powerful. And it's why you read here, they saw people getting saved day after day after day. Remember our C scale. A negative six is somebody who is hostile to Christianity. They hate everything about God. They want nothing to do with Jesus. A positive six is a fully devoted disciple of Jesus Christ who's making new disciples. A zero is the point at which somebody says yes to Jesus. We've said that love is one of the things that helps people move all along the scale towards following Jesus. As they see, man, you know, I've hated all Christians before, but I've met you and you're kind of nice. I kind of like you. That negative six to negative five, that's a big step. It's God moving. But now I want you to imagine that it's not just you that's responsible for moving that person from a negative six to receiving Jesus to being a fully devoted disciple. It's all of our jobs together. And it's led by God Himself. It's a little bit more doable now, isn't it? And you see the power of God as He wants to work in us. And how many times in the New Testament did people say to the apostles, you know, we don't know what we think about this, but we want to hear more. Come back. We want to hear you again. We need to expect that. Love helps people move all along the scale. So does a church that is multi-gifted. So thankful for our E-team. They give us opportunities and chances to share Jesus. For Easter, I want to tell you, these guys are going to have Easter bags for adults and for kids. Not for you to go blanket your neighborhood. That's not the goal of these. We're not going to make that many. But for if you have a relationship with somebody and you've been praying, God, do you want me to ask this person to church? They've got bags that will help you to do that. Give you a reason to go talk to them. E-team, thank you so much for encouraging us to share our faith. What we'll find, if our church is being the church and preaching the Bible and loving people well and worshiping Christ alone, doing the things the New Testament calls us to do, is we'll see the Holy Spirit bringing person after person to us that He is drawing to Jesus. Now, if you're here today and you don't know Jesus, and it feels like I've been talking about you all morning and aiming my whole church at you this morning, I just want to say to you, welcome. You're in the right place. You didn't misstep. We're talking about what the Bible calls us to do, but the Bible would also call you to know and love Jesus Christ. Let me just tell you really quickly what the story of the Bible is about. It starts off with God the Creator, who made this world in love. He cares about it. By the way, the best of evolutionary science is pointing to the fact that the world, the universe, must have come from a starting place. And if you ask the best physicists what happened before that starting place, the most honest ones will tell you, I have no idea. They'll say, I don't know. But we just know the universe, all of physics is pointing to the fact that something must have started it. I want to tell you, this book gives what I think is the most reasonable explanation of that starting place, that God Himself, an all-powerful being, wanted to bring beings into existence, and He did that. He made us, He gave us a tremendous freedom, tremendous potential. I don't know about you, but when I look at humanity, I see so much beauty. But He also, in giving us freedom, had to give us the opportunity to disobey him. And guess what we did from the very beginning? We did just that. We started disobeying him. We said, Creator, thanks a lot, but I'm not going to go your way. I'm going to go my own way. Adam and Eve sinned, and each of us have sinned. And that sin means that we have separated ourselves from God. The relationship that we need most in the world with God himself, we said no thank you to. When we said, no, I want to do life my own way. And often our selfish ways involve us biting, scratching, and clawing our neighbor, doing unjust things to our neighbor. And God says, I have to have consequences for those actions if I am a just God. And the just result of sin is death. But the amazing news of this book, it all points to this culmination of the love of God in sending his son Jesus into this world to teach, to love, to work miracles, but most of all, to die on the cross, to pay the penalty for our sin, so that if we will put our trust and faith in Jesus, we can have a reconciled relationship with God, our Creator, the relationship we need most in the world. That's what it means to tell good news, to say that, look, I said a minute ago, humanity has so much potential for beauty. But don't we often turn on the news or open the newspaper or boot up the screen? And the stuff we see there, it causes us to grieve in our spirit, does it not? Humanity has so much potential, and yet this is who we are? And maybe some of you are like, man, decade after decade after decade, I thought we'd get better and we're back. It seems like we're regressing even at times, doesn't it? That's sin. And the whole reason that Jesus came to this earth was to offer you and me forgiveness of our sins and a personal relationship with God. If we will say, God, I trust you. Jesus, I put my faith in you. I turn from a life of sin. I want you to be my boss. I give you my life now. Like I said, if you're here today and you feel like I was talking about you for most of the sermon, I want to say the whole reason we do this and get together is so that you'll know that God wants a relationship with you through his son, Jesus. And I would say don't let another sun go down until you have prayed to make Jesus your Lord and your Savior. Put your trust in him. The way you do that is simply by praying, God, I know I'm a sinner, but I believe in your son and I put my trust in you. We don't do an invitation these days in the same way we used to have you come forward at the end of the service. I'm not ready for that yet, but what we're doing these days is just asking you to call the church if you make a decision to follow Jesus. Call and talk to me. I want to know. I want to tell you what your next steps should look like. I want to just be a blessing to you. If that's you, I just want to say once again, don't leave here until you put your trust in Jesus. Well, back to Patrick. Not the four-leaf clover, green beads, and green drinks, Patrick, but the real St. Patrick. He did move back to Ireland, and he did begin sharing Jesus, but here was his central strategy. If you want to read about this, there's a great book called The Celtic Way of Evangelism. What are we studying? Evangelism, how to share the good news. That's what evangelism means, good news. And the Celtic way, the Patrick way, was this. He and his missionary crew, when they went to their very first town in Ireland, they asked permission to set up camp outside of the town together. And the tribal leader said, yes, you can do that. And as they set up their camp, they tried to treat each other as loving as possible. They studied the Bible together and they prayed. And visitors were always welcome in their camp. In fact, they tried to bring visitors. They would scatter into the community. They would get jobs and serve the community as much as possible. And then as it was natural, as the Holy Spirit led, they would bring people back to their camp so that they could see what the Christian loving community should look like. And what they saw happen in town after town after town after 200 towns, where the barbarians said, there's something different about you guys. Why are you so loving towards each other? And what they would see is that as people would start to get saved in a town, they would not leave. They would stay there and let those people keep coming into their camp and being raised up and trained up until indigenous leaders were ready. And then they would, once the church had started, they would leave a few of their missionaries there to help it keep growing and to help train those who had been saved. And then they would move over to the next town in the neighboring county in the 400s AD, whatever the county was. And they would start inviting visitors into their camp. They would ask permission. And then they would let people see their love and they would share Jesus. Time after time, set up a camp, invite people into the camp, see the love of Jesus, hear the message of Jesus, eventually plant a church in that town. And by March 17th, 461, the date of Patrick's death, that's why St. Patrick's Day is March 17th, 200 churches have been planted. 100,000 converts. Here's what I want to say to us. Friends, what would stop us from doing that in New Mexico right now? What would stop us from inviting people to see the love of Christ and to hear the message of Christ in northern New Mexico right now? What stands in our way? I mean, do we really think our friends are more resistant than barbarian Celtic tribes? I mean, New Mexicans are tough. We can handle spicy food. I get that. But what will stand in the way of our God? Nothing. Nothing. You know, Paul will end almost every letter the same way. Trust in Phoebe, she might be coming to you. Trust in Timothy, he's one of my disciples when he speaks. Listen to Barnabas when he comes. What is Paul saying? He's saying it's not about me. It's about Jesus. And we're a team that points people to Jesus. Sharing Jesus was never meant to be an individualistic task, but one that we all do together. Regularly. Let's pray together, friends. Our Father God, we thank you so much for the chance to be in your house today. Lord God, I know that I'm asking my church to do something that is scary. I realize that our culture says you must never talk about your Jesus. God, give us the trust in you that supersedes and is over our trust in all other voices in our lives. God, we ask amongst us that you would destroy the lie of the enemy, that we cannot obey your mission, but that God, you are loving, that you would never call us to do something that we cannot do, that you would not empower us to do. And Father, if there are any here today who have never put their faith and trust in you as Lord and Savior, I pray that today would be their day of salvation. I ask these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. We're in our time of invitation, and the invitation is two simple things today. Number one, will you trust in Jesus to share him as a team? And number two, if you've never put your trust in Jesus, would you do that today? Would you pray, confessing your sin and calling on Christ to save you? He will. As John leads us and the worship team leads us in a song, would we each respond to the Lord? And let us know this week if God is doing something in your heart. Thank you.
Let us stand together, church.
Arise and put your armor on. Hear the call of Christ again. For now the weak
Our all-church prayer gathering is this Wednesday, March 24th at 5:45 p.m. We'll have a special panel discussion on sharing Jesus in Santa Fe. That'll be in person in the CLC and on Zoom on Pastor Reed's meeting room at 5:45. So that's this Wednesday coming up. If you haven't been receiving the Zoom link or if you're a guest with us, and we'd love to have you, please contact the church office and we'll be sure to get you signed up for that. The panelists will include Rick Britton. He's a director of missions here in New Mexico, and Dr. Mike Dean. He's an interim pastor at First Baptist Las Vegas, who's also a watch care member here. And then Chad Spriggs, who's a part of the North American Mission Board here in New Mexico. After the panel discussion on Wednesday night, the band will be practicing at 6 p.m., and then the choir at 7 p.m. The youth will also be meeting in person in the CLC at 7 p.m. And so that a lot of happening this Wednesday, and so we want you to be a part of that. Easter schedule, Resurrection Sunday is coming up, and so on Good Friday, April 2nd, we'll have a drive-through communion from 5:30 to 6 here out front of the church. That's on April 2nd, Good Friday, drive-through communion at 5:30 to 6, and then we'll have a Good Friday service at 6:30. And then on Easter Sunday, April 4th, we'll have two services, one at 9 a.m. and the second at 11 a.m., and then in between, we're going to have an Easter fellowship for everyone, and so that's going to be at 10:15. There'll be no connection groups or kids worship that Sunday, and no connection groups or kids worship that Sunday. It'll be a great time to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and so make plans to be there. And as you, Pastor Reed had mentioned, we want to really encourage you to pray and consider who might God be leading you to invite to church on Easter Sunday. The youth camp is happening. We're planning to attend Student Life Youth Camp on June 22nd through the 26th down the road here at Glorieta. And so the price is $300 per student after an FBC scholarship. If you want to go, please have your $60 non-refundable deposit into the church by March 31st. We never want to a student to miss out on camp because of finances. And so if additional scholarship is needed, please come contact me and love to talk to you, work with you, so that your student be able to go to camp with us. And then later on, the youth will have a fundraiser to help with camp. As a reminder, church, we want to encourage you to find community. As Pastor Reed mentioned, one of the biggest felt needs here in Santa Fe is community. And you might have felt that recently. And so if you want to get plugged into the life of this church and really get to know people, just besides on Sunday waving, not seeing their face, but we have connection groups that meet on Zoom. And so you can see people without their mask and fellowship and get to know people more. We also have some hybrid options as well. If you have any questions about how to get plugged into a connection group, you can contact Pastor John. Church family, will you please stand as we get sent out for our benediction?
Thanks, Pastor Chris. Wednesday night, in person and on Zoom, three panelists come and talk about what they have learned about sharing Jesus in this area. Really excited to have them. If you're coming to in-person choir, you can come to in-person prayer meeting first and then go to choir right after, or youth. You got that schedule set up and excited. And then again, on Good Friday, the 5:30 to 6 drive-thru is for those who aren't comfortable yet coming in person. And then an all in-person Good Friday service at 6:30. And really excited about two services on Easter. Love that. So let's have the benediction and we'll be dismissed. And now unto you who are able to do exceedingly and abundantly beyond all we could ask or think, according to your power that is at work within us, to you be glory both now in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Go in the power of God.